Well, what time is start? 3:30.
We can start. Good afternoon, everyone. So today we have a lecture on instruments for retinal surgery, which will be presented by Dr. Aman Kumar, who's a senior resident in the Vitro Retina Services. And so he'll be telling you about different instruments which are available for scleral buckling as well as vitro retinal surgery and some adjuncts along with it. So Dr. Aman, over to you.
Thank you, sir. A very good afternoon to Chief Sir, to all the faculty and my fellow colleagues. Today's lecture will be on instruments for retinal surgery. So basically dividing the retinal surgery instruments into two parts, that is one which are used for scleral buckling and the second which are used for the vitreoretinal surgery. So first of all, I'll be going through some basic instruments which have already been discussed in the previous two talks on anterior segment instruments. But still just covering over once more, we start with the speculums. The wire speculum, it helps in maintaining the palpebral aperture for exposure of the surgical field. It is very lightweight and self-retaining and cheaply available. But the disadvantage is there cannot be any titration of the palpebral aperture. So there are a few modifications which are present. One is the Kratz-Barraker modified wire speculum, in which we can see there is no attachment of the two ends, hence there is smooth passage of instruments in this area. But this also has a disadvantage that sometimes while doing peritomy closure or while doing buckling sutures, the sutures get obstructed in this pointed ends. Most commonly used speculum in the vitreoretinal setup is the Barraker universal self-retaining speculum, which has a screw action in which the degree of exposure and the palpebral widening can be adjusted with the screw according to the need. So next we come on to the scissors, starting with the Westcott tenotomy scissors. It also has a spring action with a curved tip to prevent injury to the subconjunctival tissue and also preventing button holing. The curves are smoothened with outside blades are outer surface of the blades have smooth curves. This is used to cut the conjunctiva and the tenons during peritomy. These are the Stevens tenotomy scissors commonly used in scleral buckling surgeries. This has larger, bulkier blades with no spring action. It is controlled via the surgeon's thumb and the index finger. And this is used for deeper dissections and separation of tissues, that is tenons from the sclera. I'll be demonstrating these instruments in a small video clip. So the third scissors is the Castrovejo corneoscleral scissors. These are finer than the earlier Westcott tenotomy scissors, and this is used for enlarging or cutting of the peritomy and conjunctival, used to cut the conjunctiva. This also has a spring action. So this is just a small video clip showing the use of a Westcott tenotomy scissors used to make a conjunctival peritomy. And it is done 4 mm from the limbus, and in the end we can see Stevens tenotomy scissors used to deepen and widen the surgical plane between the sclera and the tenons, and helps increase the surgical exposure of the field. Coming to the third major group, which is the forceps. Most commonly used are the limbs forceps, which are small, fine and toothed, which have opposing plane tips present. And this gently curve for easy holding of the sutures. These are used for suture tying and also holding ocular tissue, but not used to hold the conjunctiva because it causes button holing. These are the serrated forceps commonly used in scleral buckling surgeries for holding the silicone band or the tire. It is used to manipulate the conjunctiva or the tenons tissue. And this should not be used for tying the sutures because it has serrations present, and hence we won't get a proper grip and there may be suture slippage or breaking of the sutures. These are the globe fixation forceps, which have toothed endings. There are 2 to 3 tooths present, and they are also used to hold the tenons tissue or muscle for or the globe for fixation during scleral buckling. Now, very commonly used instrument in scleral buckling is the muscle hook. So we have around I'm describing around 4 different kinds of muscle hook, but the commonly used ones in scleral buckling are the gas muscle hook, which is fenestrated as we can see, in which it is used to hook the extraocular muscles while it's bridling, and there's an aperture which is a suture can be easily passed and then the muscle can be hooked and the suture can be taken out. So there is no There is atraumatic hooking of the muscles. The commonly used is the Jameson's S-shaped muscle hook, which has a straight shaft with a 6 mm hook and a bulbous tip to avoid trauma to the muscle while hooking. So first a Jameson's muscle hook is put, and then we use a Green's muscle hook from the other end to properly hold the extraocular muscles for bridling. And then a 4-0 silk or a cotton suture can be passed beneath and tied. So this is a small video showing a Green's muscle hook, which is used to hook the medial rectus of the patient, and then these cotton sutures are passed beneath them. So very commonly used instrument is the Castrovideo calipers, which is a 3.4 inch instrument used for measuring and marking. It has a thumb screw present. There are readings present from 0 to 20 mm, and these readings are present on both the sides. So generally, this is used in, first of all, in peritomy, a 4 mm mark is taken from the limbus. Then while tying the 240 band, it is generally 14 or 15 mm from the limbus to support the vitreous base. And also while putting a tire, after localization of brakes, the Castrovideo's calipers is used to mark so that we can get a proper indent, and the scleral tire, the tire which is used, has the maximum indentation on the brake and doesn't cause fish mouthing or opening of the brake. These are the DMARS retractors, which are present in various sizes. These are handles with a curved metal ending. There are various types, different sizes present according to the need of the surgeon, and this helps in retraction of the soft tissue while suturing, while passing the scleral buckle sutures, also while passing the buckle and the tire. It helps in increasing the surgical field for the surgeon. So next, coming to the scleral indenters or the depressors. So the first and foremost step in any scleral and retinal detachment surgery is identifying and localization of the retinal breaks, which when present anteriorly to the equator are difficult to view without scleral indentation. And it also helps in differentiating between a hemorrhage or a small break, because while scleral indentation, there will be an opening of the break which is present. Also during vitrectomy, for a peripheral base, vitreous base dissection, when we are using the vitrectomy probe near the aura, then we use scleral depressors to help in bringing the surgical field easily for the surgeon and cause removing the vitreous traction from the base. So this is the most commonly used Schockett scleral depressor, also used in OPDs very routinely. This is the thimble depressor, which we generally get with our indirect ophthalmoscopes, in which a thumb is put here and this bulbous end is non-traumatic, is used for depression. A flint depressor causes a greater area of depression and also used in pediatric cases. So commonly used instrument for mostly all intraocular surgeries is the Castrovideo's needle holder, which is a S-shaped locking system. It has a broader end as compared to the Barraker, which I'll be describing later. And it has serrated edges to support the suture and decrease the slippage. And it is generally used for holding larger sutures like 5-0 Ethibon and 6-0 Vicryl. The 5-0 Ethibon, which is the most commonly used suture for passing the scleral buckle and the tire, it has a locking mechanism. The Barraker needle holder is a smaller curved tip and has fine serrations to decrease slippage of the sutures, and it is conventionally non-locking mostly, but there are models which have a locking mechanism also. So this is used for conjunctival suturing. So this is an instrument, the Watzke sleeve spreader, and after the 240 band is passed and circlage band is passed in buckling, the final tie can either be done with a suture or a Watzke sleeve can be passed in the two, like shown in this picture, the two ends of the 240 encircling band. The Watzke sleeve is also a silicone band which is passed, and this we can easily tighten or loosen the final tie according to the need of the indent required, and this helps in fixing the ends of the silicone band. So this is the Watzke sleeve spreader. The Watzke sleeve silicone is kept here, and when pressed, it separates and can be easily passed between the two ends of the silicone band. The cryoprobe works on the Joule-Thomson effect, that is, the gas under pressure when suddenly released cools the surrounding temperature. So these are the various probes which are used. This has a bulbous ending, this has a flatter ending, and the main aim is the covering all the retinal breaks and causing cryopexy or opposing the RPE with the retina. So it is generally done around the tears, and the endpoint is retinal whitening, and there shouldn't be any crystal formation. And these generally have an insulating sleeve present so that the amount of cooling only happens at the end and not at the shaft, thus decreasing collateral damage. And the commonly used probe size for scleral buckling is a 2 or 2.5 mm probe. Cryoprobe is also used commonly in diabetic patients and vasculitic patients in which anterior retinal cryopexy is done. Anterior to the equator, the is generally inferiorly 8 spots are put with a cryoprobe to cause the ischemic retina to become the ischemic retina which is releasing the VEGF to decrease in making it anoxic. So these are the common uses. Just a quick description on the bands and the tires used. And the most commonly used nowadays is the silicone rubber and the circumferential buckles which provide the support at the vitreous base. The 240 bond band most commonly used, which is 2.5 mm wide. The radial buckles which were used earlier provided localized support for retinal tears, and they were preferred for more posterior lesions. But these are the commonly used tires for anterior retinal breaks and for example retinal dialysis. This is a 277 symmetric tire which has a 7 mm wide length, and it has a groove in between through which this 240 band passes. This is the asymmetric tire in which there is a longer limb and a shorter limb, and then again there is a groove through which the 240 band passes. The asymmetric tires generally have a better indent present, and according to the localization of brakes, these tires are placed. During scleral buckling, as there is increased manipulation of the ocular tissue, the episcleral vessels and all, there can be increased bleeding can be present. Hence, external diathermy can be used. We generally prefer a bipolar diathermy in which there's an active electrode and a dispersive electrode, which is a 1.7 megahertz. It is connected to a radio frequency cautery unit. So this basically covers the scleral buckling instruments mostly. And now coming to the second part of the lecture, which has the vitreoretina surgery instruments. So starting with the trocars, the cannulas, ports and plugs. So outer diameter of the vitrectomy instrument is given the term as gauge. Higher the gauge of the instrument, smaller is the outer diameter. So the latest trocar cannula system is developed so that there is less traction on the vitreous base on entry and exit, and hence decrease vitreous incarceration or pull on the retina. These cannula maintain alignment between the sclera and the conjunctiva and is less traumatic to the wound borders. So I'll be explaining in the further slides how these trocar cannula are placed, and so that there is the system of the MIVS came in place. So these are the different types of trocars and cannulas. We have the 23 gauge, which is the orange colored, the 25 gauge, which is the blue and green colored, and the violet colored 27 gauge trocars. These are the micro cannulas which are present, valved cannulas, and this has the edge plus trocar system design, in which there is atraumatic wound construction and increased sealing of the wounds post operatively. So the MIVS is the minimally invasive vitreoretinal surgery, which comprises of the 23, 25 and a 27 gauge. And we can also use hybrid vitrectomy, in which combining different gauges and surgical techniques. For example, in diabetics, in TRDs, we generally construct a 23 gauge, and then when operating near the retina or when the membranes are removed, the TRD is removed, we switch on to the 27 gauge because of decreased traction on the retina. So I've explained the two types of cannula, which are the non-valved and the valved. Earlier, the non-valved were commonly used, and in which the scleral plugs were needed for IOP control because there was constant fluid loss from the cannulas. But the soft tip instruments, the silicone soft tip instruments, which bend easily, could be easily passed with ease. Whereas in the valved cannulas, there is precise IOP control, but there is no need of these plugs, and the passage of the soft tip instruments is difficult. Hence, as it's a closed system, vents are used, which I'll be showing in the later images, during either oil or heavy liquid injection. So these are the images depicting a non-valved cannula and valved cannulas. The non-valved are in this scleral plug. This This is an image, magnified image of the microcannula and the trocar system. Microcannula is around 4 mm, and the entry is also around 4 mm, making a complete around 8 mm. And the leading edge has a cutting edge, and the which is the latest, the edge plus V shaped trocar cannula system. And these are the sizes of the various sclerotomies, which are made with a 20, 23, 25, and 27 gauge. The 0.9 mm 20 gauge, which was initially developed, then came the 0.7, 0.5, and 0.4 mm. These are the size of the sclerotomies made with these various sizes of the trocar cannula. So, going into the history a little bit, the 0.9 system, the 20 gauge system, is a 0.9 mm sclerotomy, came in 1972 and invented by Conor O'Malley. The 23 gauge is 0.7 mm, came in 2005, and it was invented by Klaus Eckardt from Germany. And the 25 gauge is a 0.5 mm system in 2002, and this was by Fuji et al. And the latest to the armamentarium is the 27 gauge 0.4 mm, which came in 2010, now routinely used in diabetic surgeries or even macular surgeries, which was developed by Oshima et al. So this is a small video clip showing how in a phakic patient a 4 mm was measured with the end of the trocar, and a cannula is placed in the sclera. So a biplanar incision was made, first going 30 degrees and then going towards the midvitreous cavity, thus making a more self-sealed incision and decreased fluid loss and maintaining IOP. So earlier, when 20 gauge was there to make the sclerotomies, a microvitreoretinal blade was used, which was a lancet-shaped tipped, which was attached to a plastic handle, disposable, and it could have been a straight or a angled, and it was generally a 1.4 mm blade with a 0.89, around 0.9 mm, which was used for 20 gauge instruments. And it is nowadays used in either a retained intraocular foreign body removal or during dislocated lens, when a phragmatome is used to remove the lens. So next, coming into the infusion cannula system, this is the system which is first inserted and last removed in a vitreoretinal surgeries. So earlier cannulas, the 20 gauge cannulas, were of different sizes, the 2.4, 4 mm and the 6 mm, and they had flanged edges, and they were generally tied with the vicryl sutures to the sclera to support it. But nowadays there are self-retaining cannulas used commonly in MIVS surgeries, and these just have to be, surgeon has to make sure that the cannula is inserted, is visible in the vitreous cavity before starting the infusion, or the infusion will go into the subretinal space. So here we can see, after the cannula is inserted, the surgeon is checking that the infusion cannula is in the vitreous space, and then only the infusion is started, and the surgery can be proceeded. So next is the endoillumination. It is again available in 23, 25 and 27 gauge, and the commonly used nowadays is the xenon straight illuminators, and various filters have been provided to decrease the retinal toxicity. Earlier were used halogen and metal halide lamps, mercury vapors, which caused increased phototoxicity to the retina, hence now not commonly used. Even LED sources are now used in few machines. So this is the common endo illuminator used in the Constellation machine, which has a straight tip. So Alcon has even provided with other various modifications of this tip, which is the sapphire wide angle tip. This is used to decrease the glare, especially during fluid air exchange, when the cavity is filled with air and there is increased glare. This has a more more peripheral visualization can take place. The other modification is the shielded, which they have named the bullet tip, and this also has a greater field, has an easy insertion and a uniform illumination to ease the surgery. Another light which I would like to throw light upon is the mini light source, and it's the chandelier illumination, which provides diffuse illumination and leaves the surgeons both hands free. And this is very commonly used for bimanual surgeries in diabetics, in which a separate 25 gauge non-whirled port is made generally superiorly, and the chandelier is placed like the infusion cannula facing the midvitreous cavity. It generally provides 106 degree wide, and the illumination can be controlled via the machine, and then both the hands of the surgeons are free, in which one, a cutter can be taken, intraocular scissors can be used, forceps can be used, and this has a multi-port illumination system. And nowadays, even few modifications are there in which the trocar itself has a light source and ends the surgeon remains by-handed and can use both hands for the surgery. So coming to the most important equipment for vitreoretinal surgery, that is the vitrectomy probe. So just in the basics in the theory. So it is driven by two mechanisms, either the electric or the pneumatic. The electric uses electricity to drive this motor, but it is heavier and more bulkier. But the pneumatic ones, which are commonly used, uses pressurized air to drive the diaphragm and the inner tube forward. It is lightweight. So the parts of a vitrectomy probe is the cutter house, the motor diaphragm, and the spring action. And the cutter tip is connected with the steel tubes. So now this is the latest vitrectomy probe which we use commonly at RP Center. It is the Ultra Vitrectomy Probe by Alcon. It's the 23 gauge orange colored, and this tip shows that the thumb can be placed here and this part of the probe is facing this tip. There are three lines connected. One is the ultrasound energy which is there. Other is the aspiration which side which is there, and third is the enduring proportional reflux if some fluid has to be reflected back from the probe. So these are ergonomically designed, pneumatically driven, and it causes linear cutting. This is microsurgical size, lighter weight, and there are presence of stiffening sleeves which I'll be showing for further to decrease the flexibility of the instruments and health, hence more peripheral vitreous dissection can be done, especially useful in 25 gauge vitrectomies. So this is the conventional spring bend vitrector in which there's a spring driven pneumatic cutting mechanism was there, and it resulted in around 2500 cuts per minute, and the pneumatic pulses used to push the cutter to one direction, but the recoil of the spring used to cause the return of the cutting probe. Hence it was dependent on the spring recoil system. But nowadays the ultraweight dual pneumatic cutter is used, in which an air pulse is used to open and close. It controls both the opening and the closing of the cutter probe, and thus larger increased cut rates are possible, up to 7500 and even 10,000 cuts per minute, and in which duty cycle can be set by the surgeon in the instrument. So just some advances in the vitrectomy probe. This is the two-dimensional cutter, in which in the classic cutter only the one edge of the cut inner cutting was used for cutting the vitreous. But in two-dimensional cutter, both the edges of the cutter are used, and hence while going in and while going out, this causes cutting of the vitreous, thus causing doubling of the cutting rate, up to 16,000 cuts per minute. This high duty cycle is achieved because the port is nearly always open as the blade moves back and forth. So this was the sleeve which I was talking about, generally used in 25 gauge vitrectomies because of thinner instruments being more malleable, causing more bending or breaking. Hence these sleeves have shown to increase the rigidity of these instruments. So they have generally a 5 mm supporting sleeve near the proximal end for keeping it straight and rigid. And because of the newer designs of the cutting probes, we can easily go nearer the surface of the retina, and this gives access to tighter tissue planes. There is decreased length between the cutting probe and the retinal tissue, and hence more useful in diabetic tractional membrane release, the fibrovascular membrane release, or the ERM removals. So this is a small video in which peripheral vitrectomy is shown, in which high cut rate and low vacuum is used for peripheral based dissection. And this is the shave mode of the Constellation vitrectomy system, in which the cutting probe is mostly closed but open minimally, and light pipe is positioned so that the vitreous can be viewed against it, and there can be an easy view for the surgeon so that the vitrectomy probe can use to cut the vitreous. And even indentation can be used, but nowadays wide angle viewing systems are there in which we can reach up to the aura, but still we can use scleral indenters, or even buds can be used to see the tissue anterior to the equator. And a commonly performed surgery is the interface vitrectomy at our center, in which under fluid, after the FAX is done, the vitreous which is left peripherally is removed with a cutter under the view of the endolight. So just a little about the different vitrectomy modes and the duty cycle control. This is the core mode, in which the port remains open majority of the time, which is used to mainly do the core vitrectomy when we are away from the retina. the vacuum is high and even the cut rate is low. The 50-50 mode in which the 50% of the time the port is open and 50% time the port is closed. And the shave mode, which we just saw, generally when we are nearer to the retina or the peripheral vitreous shaving is done, in which the port remains closed majority of the time. It's the closed bias duty cycle. And in the constellation vitrectomy modes, there are three. The most commonly used is the proportional vacuum, which is the linear vitrectomy mode, in which the cut rate is fixed by the surgeon and by the foot pedal only the vacuum is controlled, and hence according to the surgeon's preference while doing core or while doing peripheral vitrectomy or while doing vitrectomy near to the retina, the vacuum can be adjusted, or while doing FAX or while removing the subretinal fluid. The 3D, the dual dynamic drive. In this, the surgeon controls both the vacuum and the cutting rate by the foot pedal, and hence it's more little more difficult or little more control is required, as because both the vacuum and the cutting are dynamic in this. And momentary vitrectomy is linear vacuum is there, and only in between interspersed cutting can be done. For example, and when a membrane is, for example, a diabetic membrane is done sucked into the vitrectomy probe, a cutting cutting probe can be switched on and the membrane can be trimmed, used for segmentation. In this, different types I've already explained, the different four types of the vitrectomy probes and their gauges. These are the vitrectomy probes and their color denomination according to the gauges. So next, coming on to the aspiration, we have divided into two, which is the active and the passive. The active is either based on the venturi or the peristaltic systems, and it is used for aspiration during vitrectomy and using this extrusion canal, which can be either a soft tip or a blunt tip. In the soft tip, there's a silicone tip cannula which is attached to this, so that it is atraumatic to the retinal surface, and this causes, it is again foot pedal controlled linear aspiration, only vacuum is switched on, and this is used through induced PVD. It can be used during air fluid exchange, during aspiration of subretinal fluid, during aspiration of heme which is there. This is the disposable 25 gauge backflush needle which is present. And in the passive backflush probes, it is based on the intraocular and extraocular pressure difference. It is finger controlled, and it cleans the away the blood remnants and identifies the membranes and also aspirates the subretinal fluid, but passively, not requiring foot pedal control or the machine vacuum. It's the commonly used Charles flute needle or the Ivanovich backflush needle, which is used to remove the subretinal fluid or remove the pre-retinal blood, and also used in fluid air exchange. So a small video on subretinal fluid drainage using active suction, in which aspiration using this is the soft tip cannula silicone is used, a retinotomy site is made, and we can see the subretinal fluid getting drained and the retina getting settled. So this is the double barrel or double bore needle, which is used in injecting PFCL and aspirating passive aspiration of the balanced salt solution which is present in the globe. So it prevents unintended high IOP rise, as while the central inner bowl is thicker, the PFCL is continuously injected, and through these multiple holes the BSS gets absorbed. So this permits controlled IOP in the globe. So a small note, even though not instrument, this is an adjunct used in vitreoretinal surgery. So a small note on the perfluorocarbon liquids. These are high density with high specific gravity. It has high interfacial tensions, and it causes. It is used in difficult GRTs, giant retinal tears related RDs. It is used in peripheral drainage of the fluid in retinal detachment surgeries. It is used in dislocated lens, in retained intraocular foreign bodies, even used in when extensive PVR is there to flatten out the retina, and then peeling the membranes under PFCL, thus it is used as a third hand of the surgeon. So in this picture, we can see this was a GRT, temporal GRT with macula off, completely flap was folded upon one another, and this was PFCL assisted done, and we can see the GRT is well settled, and this is the site where the laser marks are put, and a PFCL oil exchange is done at the end. So commonly used instruments in the VR OT is the phragmatome, which is used in dislocated lens removal, when there is a harder lens, whether there is a harder nucleus sclerosis lens present in the vitreous cavity, and this tip is longer than a phaco emulsification probe. This is a wrench which is there used to tighten this probe into the phaco fragmentome, and this works. This also works on the principle of ultrasonic emulsification, which is derived from this probe attached to the Constellation vitrectomy machine. This is a port in which there is constant aspiration of fluid or the lens particles. So endodiathermy is the next instrument. It is used for controlling bleeding in diabetics, or in when vascular fronds are there, NVEs are there, in which the bleeders are cauterized. It's like an internal cautery which is there. There is a drainage retinotomy when it's made during retinal detachment surgeries to drain the retinal subretinal fluid. Then even during marking of breaks, because after a fluid air exchange, the breaks can be easily missed and later cause re-detachments, as we have not lasered them. Hence, before a fluid exchange, a diathermy is used to mark all the retinal breaks when we have after the vitrectomy. So the Constellation uses a bipolar diathermy. This is a 25 gauge Alcon diathermy Constellation, in which this is the tip of the this is a sharp tip in which the diathermy probe is connected to the outlet. So next is the endophotocoagulation, which is the most common commonly used instrument for retinopexy nowadays. It is used to treat retinal tears. It is used for pan-retinal photocoagulation during diabetic surgeries, and when using them, the microscope should be fitted with filters so as to avoid damage to the surgeon and the assistant. And it can be in various forms. It can be curved so that more anteriorly we can view, and we can reach a greater area. And then nowadays, a self-illuminated laser probes are also available. So the commonly used laser is the 532 nanometer argon green laser used in vitreoretinal surgeries. So talking about retained intraocular foreign bodies, most commonly are the magnetic foreign bodies which are there. And after a complete workup, an X-ray and or a CT scan, during a removal of the intraocular foreign bodies, we use these magnets commonly. These are the intraocular magnets, which are thinner and longer so that they can be used in intraocular areas. And this is the extraocular magnet, and this being bulkier has more magnetic power, which is used to after the foreign body is brought closer to the scleral surface or the limbal surface. This is used to hold that magnetic scleral body and put it out of the eye. So generally, if the foreign body is more than 5 mm, we use a limbal route. So a paraspinal lensectomy or a lens aspiration is done prior so that it can be used can be removed by a limbal route. So this is a small video in which we can see that the extraocular magnet is used to remove the foreign body after it has been brought by the foreign body forceps into the sclerotomy side mate here. So these are the foreign body forceps which we use, the two or three pronged foreign body baskets, as it's called. These are serrated at the end for a good grip of the foreign body. And this is generally done, has to be done after the foreign body is freed from the vitreous and there is no traction to the retina, which will cause a retinal break or a retinal detachment or even a GRT and vitreous incarceration later. So in this, we can see a handshake technique being done by manually by two forceps, in which the foreign body is placed along its length and removed from the sclerotomy port, and the smaller sclerotomy is needed. Because if we remove it like this, then more chance of vitreous incarceration or retinal detachment is there. So this is the commonly used for forceps in our OT, in which we can see when the surgeon is moving the tip of this foreign body forceps towards himself, there is opening of these prongs, and then we can grasp the foreign body and then pull it out of either the limbal root or the sclerotomy site made from the MBR blade. And then coming to the intraocular scissors, and these are the commonly used curved scissors nowadays, used in fibrovascular proliferations and diabetic TRDs, and used for segmentation and delamination of the membranes, and hence removing the traction which is there on the retina. The earlier used scissors were the horizontal scissors and the vertical scissors, but this provides more view to the surgeon and better control of the membranes, and it is conformal to the retinal curvature. Next is the intraocular forceps. We'll be discussing the three most common intraocular forceps which are used. And this is the max grip forceps, which has a blunt distal ending. It is micro textured there and serrated, and it is used to grasp fibrous membranes like ERMs or PVRs or fibrovascular proliferations after it has been removed from the retina via intraocular scissors or via cutter. The second is the end grasping forceps, which is again very commonly used to remove subretinal bands in old RDEs in which there is intrinsic PVR changes, in which subretinal bands are preventing the retina to settle back. So generally a diathermy is made and the subretinal bands are pulled out in toto from the retinal surface. And it is also used commonly in ERM peeling after staining of the membrane, and also used in, for example, there is a PVR which is present causing a fixed fold or a star fold or a macular pucker. Hence these forceps are used by the surgeon like this, in which while pressing these grooves, this causes closing of the opposing of the edges and thus easily removing the membrane from the site of the ports only. These are the most commonly used intraocular forceps, the ILM forceps, commonly used in macular hole surgeries, in vitreomacular traction surgeries, and this is used to release the tangential traction which is there. These are atraumatic, and these don't have serrations, these have blunt endings, and these are also have the same mechanism of action like the max grip or the end grasping forceps. And a small video in which the patient is suffering from a macular hole in the left eye, in which the surgeon is using the ILM forceps to take these flaps and was an inverted ILM flap over the macular hole after staining the ILM with a brilliant blue green dye. So coming to just again, these are adjuncts to vitreoretinal surgeries, commonly used dyes which are termed chromovitrectomy. So I won't go into much detail, but just the commonly used ones are the BBG dye, which are used in ILM or ERM for negative staining. Dual staining can be done, first to stain the negatively stain the ERM and then to stain the ILM under the ERM. So heavy BBGs can be made so that the dye gets settled on the posterior pole. So 10% dextrose is added. It's commonly done at our center. And ILM blue, dual blue dye is there for both ILM and ERM peeling. In this, pegylated glucose is there. And other dyes are also there. The tricot is there, the triamcinolone acetonide, which helps in staining the vitreous, helps in PVD induction, and it highlights the vitreous even for peripheral shaving. And earlier used were the endocyanine green dyes, but they have caused retinal toxicity, hence now not in so much use. The infracyanine green was also used, but these all have retinal toxicities. So now coming to the scrapers used in vitreoretinal surgeries. This is the Tano's diamond dusted membrane scraper, or commonly called the DDMS. It has a silicone tip which is non-traumatic, coated with diamond dusts, and it is helped in scraping atraumatically over the retina, causing removal of which are the membranes which are tightly adherent to the retina, or the PVR membranes which are tightly adherent, causing tautness of the retina and not causing the retina to settle, and which are difficult to remove with the forceps because sometimes the membranes get tethered and don't come in toto. Hence these are used to massage the retina and remove those membranes, and after the initiation of the removal we can easily remove it with a end grasping or a max grip forceps. So another scraper is the Finesse Flex Loop, recently developed. Is the nitinol substance loop, again has fine serrations at the end, and it is also used to initiate ILM peeling, atraumatic ILM peeling, but there are studies which show it causes more damage to the RNFL, and hence we still prefer the ILM forceps pinch and peel technique developed by Klaus Eckhardt, in which the ILM is removed using the ILM forceps. And this has lower rates of retinal alterations, and there are studies which show that fewer occurrence of retinal hemorrhages are there in the areas peeled. So this is the end which has a loop there, and the surgeon can even view through the loop and see what the membrane or the ILM is being peeled. So these were used earlier, in earlier days, the retinal picks, in which the subretinal band or a membrane can be easily hooked onto these and can be pushed. But nowadays they are generally used lesser, and we have shifted to ILM or ERM forceps. I just wanted to briefly tell you about the various handles. Like I've already explained in the videos, this was the most commonly used handle in which the surgeon presses these grooves and causes closing of the instrument. Same for these instruments, these are intraocular forceps handles. And in this, like I've shown in the foreign body forceps, when the surgeon pulls these, it causes opening of the prongs of the instruments. So in retinal detachment surgeries, commonly used adjunct is a silicon oil. So for injecting and extracting of silicon oil to support the causing intraocular tamponade, we use syringes in, with needles. These are again available in all three gauges. And while using this, we use this vent, which is attached to the other port, and this which causes the air to get released and silicon oil to get injected from the other port, hence maintaining a balanced IOP and tamponading the retina. So in this we can see the vent is placed here, which causing air egress, and here the oil is getting injected. It is generally done, the surgeon keeps checking the intraocular pressure externally, and it is generally we don't do it more than the pupillary plane. So again a small brief slide on silicon oil being an adjunct to vitreoretinal surgeries, and these are heavier than water, and these are used for intraocular tamponading in retinal detachment surgeries or diabetic massive TRDs, in which there are already secondary rhabdomyogenous breaks which have been formed. So it has a specific gravity of 0.97, and this are available in 1000 centistrokes and 5000 centistrokes. Commonly used is the 1000 centistrokes, which is easier to inject and which is removed earlier. And nowadays even dense with subretinal silicon oils are there, and the uses are the RD with proliferative vitreoretinopathy, or there's a GRT in which a PFCL oil exchange is done, a coloboma related RD, and pediatric RDs in which the patient is uncooperative for positioning, and if the patient has to travel, or there is one-eyed patient, or there is traumatic vitreous incarceration, then we prefer silicon oil injection. So while covering silicon oils, we also will cover the gases, and the commonly used are the SF6 and the C3F8 gases, and these have a property of buoyancy, surface tension, and interfacial tension, generally used in more fresher RDs with superior breaks, and in which the patient can maintain position, and there is the advantage that this gets dissolved on its own, hence a second surgery is not required. So generally SF6 concentration doubles its volume, and C3F8 quadruples its volume, and the isoexpansal forms are 18 and 14% respectively. So this is a small table from Stephen Ryan Retina, in which the three adjuncts which we used, the AIR, SF6 and C3F8, and their this I already said that this doubles and this quadruples in duration 1 to 2 weeks and 6 to 8 weeks, and these are the non-expansile concentrations which are used. So in this image we can see that the assistant is used to fill the syringe, gas syringe with 50 cc syringes there, and the SF6 is being loaded. So if for this is a silicone oil injector which is there. This is the auto injector which is present, an automated 10 cc syringe in which the oil is filled, and this can be used for both injection and extraction. It's called the VFI, viscous fluid injector. So like I was I had explained about the non-walled force, non-walled trocar cannula. So earlier the plug holding forceps were used to place these cannulas, these plugs inside those micro cannulas, and they held in securely holding the sclerotomy and hence maintaining the IOP. And nowadays these cannulas, these forceps are used in holding the vents while injecting silicon oil or gases. And this is mechanism of action of opening is, while when you press the limbs of these instrument, it causes opening of this, and then this has grooves which were made to hold these scleral plugs. So just as one slide on subretinal instruments, the commonly one used is the 41 gauge translocation needle, which has which causes a self-sealing retinotomy, commonly used in submacular hemorrhages surgeries in which subretinal TPA, AN, and anti-VEGF is injected in cases like of breakthrough bleeds in ARMD or PCV. It is also used in subretinal biopsies in primary vitreoretinal lymphomas. So now coming on to the wide-angle visualization system. So for a vitreoretinal surgery to happen, the most important thing is viewing the retina as much as possible with as least difficulty. So the two most common based systems are the contact based and the non-contact based. The contact based systems are give us a more wider angle viewing, and we can perform work better in the periphery, and there is decreased aberrations and reflections. And in the non-contact based, the advantage is that we don't need any assistant required. It is attached to the microscope, and there is easier handling and manipulation of the globe, and the indentation is easier, and there is less corneal trauma, there is decreased chance of epithelial damage, and the better viewing is there during air fluid exchange. And but the disadvantage of the contact base, it needs a skilled assistant to hold the wide angle lens over the cornea and move it as and when the surgeon is viewing the specific quadrant, and it has a learning curve and indentation is difficult. And non-contact has lesser field of view, and it has more aberrations. For example, a cornea which is post-LASIK or keratoconus, it is difficult in that, and there is more ocular rotation needed for viewing the periphery. So these are the commonly used lenses. I haven't added all, but these are the commonly used lenses used in RP center. This is the mini quad XL wide angle lens with a field of view of 112 to 134 degrees, and we can see up till the aura in this, and it is ideal for retinal detachment and giant retinal tear surgeries. There's a magnification of around 0.39 times. This is the other lens, which is the central retinal lens, which causes more magnification of 0.71, and it is used for membrane peeling or more posterior polar pole pathologies. So this is the handle which the assistant holds, and the lens gets easily fitted on this end, which is a semicircular end. And now coming to the other commonly used lenses, which is the irrigating Machimer's direct lens, which is used in which a virtual erect image is found, and it is a 45 diopter plano concave used in posterior polar, for example, ILM peeling or removal of the ERM or membrane removal while diabetic surgeries. And this is the most commonly used macular self-retaining lens, which is the Chalam lens. And it is after a drop of OVD is put on the cornea, this easily gets placed on the cornea, and with these help of these flanges, it remains on the ocular surface due to negative suction. And it was developed by Dr. K.V. Chalam, and it has a dioptric power of around minus 66 diopters with a magnification of 1.5x. And it has basically three components of lenses, which has the top has a plano concave lens, the middle has a magnifying lens, and the it also has a 15 degree prism. So the field of view is around 15 degrees, showing between both arcades, and it is very good for posterior pole macular surgeries. This is an image of a macular the self-retaining Chalam lens put, and in which the flanges are there, and this can be the assistant is required sometimes to rotate these lenses if you have to see more periphery. So this was the non-contact lens system, which is attached to the microscope head, and it is sterilizable. And there are two lenses which are present: the yellow lens, which is 128 diopters, and the green lens, which is 60 diopter. And this one is used for macular surgeries, more magnification, and this one is used for generally core vitrectomy or peripheral vitrectomy. So this is the image, the wide angle viewing systems, which allows similar view like the indirect ophthalmoscope to the surgeon, and just showing a difference between the two procedures. So the latest in the vitreoretinal surgeries is the 3D vitreoretinal visualization system, or the heads-up Ingenuity visualization system, in which it is termed as a digitally assisted visualization system, in which three components are there. Two 1080p cameras are attached to the microscope with a processing unit, and it is attached to the 55K OLED LED display, which is 4K, and there it's a heads-up. Hence, the surgeon can easily. It is better ergonomically, and it is better. It is the surgeon wears the passive Polaroid glasses because it gives a three-dimensional view, and there are different filters to enhance the visualization of various structures of the retina. The various benefits are: it's improved ergonomics, decreases the phototoxicity, there is better view till the periphery, the aura is visible, even the pars plana can be seen in this, and there's enhanced depth of field and better stereopsis, there is lesser glare and asthenopia, and it's a very good teaching tool because all the people standing in the OR, even the assistant, are seeing the exact same thing like the surgeon, and it can be a direct surgeon to assistant interaction. And this is another attachment, which is the latest microscope integrated OCT, the MIOCT, which is real-time intraoperative OCT, which is a spectral domain OCT attached to the microscope. The rescan 700 is one of the examples which is attached to the Lumera 700 microscopes, and the OCT appears in the eyepiece, or it is even available with the this vitreoretinal the 3D visualization system, where the OCT comes on the side and the surgeon can, while seeing the OCT, perform the various maneuvers. It is used in macular hole surgeries, during ERM removals, during vitromacular tractions, during retinal detachments. So this is a very important addition to the latest advances in the vitreoretinal surgeries. Thank you.
So thank you, Avan. That was a very good presentation, and I'm sure you all appreciate that there's so many instruments which are there in retina which you need to know, and it's been very nicely explained how each instrument works. And so if there are any questions which you want to ask regarding this.
There is one question from Abhinjit about how to approach very high myopes in vitreoretinal.
Yeah,
So, sir, in very high myopes, in first of all, the axial length of a myopic eye is higher. Hence, to reach the retina with the standard instruments is more difficult. So, there have been developments in which longer instruments have been made. But we can also make the trocar cannula site, which is there generally, we can make it more posteriorly, so that there is easy reaching of the retina during myopic vitrectomies.
Yeah, so just to add to it, that definitely it's very challenging to operate in very high myopes, and if you are a standalone setup, you might not have all the long instruments which you need, but definitely it's very challenging to operate in high myopes. So then obviously you can try to move the port saddle back, or you can try to indent, lower the IOP inside the eye and try to indent the instrument saddle, but definitely it's a little challenging in high myopic eyes.
But just one more thing you can do is,
yes sir,
you can take off the cannula.
Yes, sir.
The cannula occupies a little bit of that.
Yes.
It's called the cannula. You insert the instrument directly through the sclerotomy.
Yes, I think that's an excellent idea, because if you do that, then you can take the instrument as much inside as you want. Otherwise, the instruments are made to stop at a particular point at a particular level. Otherwise, you can go as much inside as you want. I think that's a very good
idea. Yeah, this is published.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So the second question they are asking is, sir, can we use the same instruments in pediatric population? So we can use the same instruments in pediatric population as well, but you have to just be careful, because these are smaller eyes, so you don't want to, you know, take the whole length of the instrument inside. So in very small eyes, if like in ROP eyes, or you know, like a newborn eyes, you might have seen, we don't insert the trocar cannula fully. We just go to half the length, and once the cannula has passed, that is 4 mm has passed, then the sclera gives way. Then simultaneously, with one hand, you push the cannula inside and you take the trocar out. So you don't end up, you know, entering the whole trocar cannula inside the eye, the 8 mm, because that can injure the retina. And obviously, there's another instruments which are there, which are known as the short ones. So they are available in different gauges, 25, 27, they are also available. So they are smaller in length, but obviously you need one more set if you want to use them. The third question is in dual cutter port will always be open, will it cause more traction on the retina? Yeah, Aman, you want to answer this?
Because of the very high cut rate going up till the 16,000 cuts per minute, the vitreous is generally liquefied and then taken up by the cutter, hence there is no traction on the retina which is seen. In lower cut rates, in the earlier the spring based actions, then there was increased traction, but nowadays the cut rate is so high that the vitreous is liquefied and then aspirated, so there is hardly no.
So what he showed you was a 16,000 cutter, which he showed you. So 16,000 cutter we don't have right now, we use the 10,000 cuts, the constellation which you see. So the dual cut he showed for as an advances which is there. So basically our cutters, you know, cut one way and then the air, you know, by both mechanisms it tends to push it back, the spring is not there. But here what is happening, the blade is sharp on both the sides, so it doesn't waste the other end as well, and with the same mechanism it cuts on both ways. That's what he wants to say. So this will enable us to go to higher cutting. To go to higher cutting, obviously the cutter stays, the port stays, the amount which fluid goes in stays for a lesser time, so obviously traction is supposed to be less. unless you know increase the suction to such an high limit that you know it's able to do it. So as you increase the cutting, if you don't increase the suction, then the fluid will not go inside the cutter, right? So as you increase the cutting, the suction will also have to be increased so that the something can go inside. Otherwise, the cutter is just doing this and nothing is going inside, right? So.
No, actually, not much advantage of this twin cutting, you know. Dork has introduced it in their machine. But you have to know what is actually, what, how much high rate do we need? Do we need 16,000 cuts really in clinical retinal vitreous surgery? So nobody knows what exactly thinner, how thin the instrument should be, 27 gauge, more than that, or what cut rate should be optimum. So right now, 10,000 works quite well. So most of the vitrectomy machines have about 8,000 to 10,000 cut rate, which works reasonably well. You can't say higher cut rate has to be superior. You can't say 16,000 superior. He's Dr. Bajaj is exactly correctly said that both sides are cutting. That's what happens in the DORC instrument, DORC cutter. But most of the other vitrectomy machines, I don't want to take any names, but most of them have a say 5,000, 7,500, 10,000 cut rate. That works reasonably well for all vitreous surgeries.
So there are no more questions.
No, sir. In YouTube also there are no more questions.
So I think you should just go back and see all these instruments. We have all these instruments in the OT. It's a huge advantage to all of you that all this equipment and all these instruments which is shown you are there in our operation theater itself. So you don't need to go and see anywhere else. You can just go to our operation theater and you have to just keep your eyes and ears open and see what is actually happening in front of you. What are the settings on the machine? What is this equipment? If you look at the, you know, that the table which the sister has put up, maybe you don't know a few or don't recognize a few instruments. So, you know, hold those instruments in your hand, try to use them, try to press them, see how it works. If you don't know the use, ask your senior, how does this instrument work? Where is it applied? And we have a lot of instruments which are there with sister which might not actually be on your table as well. So you can go and ask, okay, this instrument has been taught to us. Can you please show us this instrument? How does the instrument work? Because once you see all those instruments, you know, you'll have to distinguish between them. Sometimes they all appear to be pretty similar. But once you have them in front, you can actually feel them and feel which is pointed, what is serrated, where is it rounded, and then it will be more easier for you to appreciate and distinguish between these instruments. So you should go and actually physically see these instruments in the OT, and then you will learn much more about the instruments than by seeing photos. So that will help you a lot.
More things, they should use the simulator in the, you know, the surgical lab downstairs. And second is, when you see the instruments, which Parijat has very rightly said, visit the sterilization room also, how the instruments are clean, packed, and then sterilized. What are the various ways of sterilization of retina instruments? They're delicate instruments, you can't just do it, you know, whatever you feel like. So you've got to know which are the instruments which are plasma sterilized, which are ETO sterilized, where you can use a flash autoclave. So you better know all that. Because that may be more, also very important, because all the sterilization equipment, we have the plasma, we have ETO, we have flash, we have the bigger steam autoclaves. So all those, you got to see all that. How do you clean instruments from the ultrasonic cleaner? So just don't come to the theater and go away, because you should know these instruments have to be re-sterilized and then reused. Otherwise, you'll get infection in endophthalmitis.
There is one more class.
Even class of sterilization of OT, instruments and disinfection of OT, should not impose any class. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
There is one more question about how to prevent subretinal migration of foil or PLCA in colobomatous eye.
So you have to prevent traction, no? You have to do a good PVD removal, you have to remove all membranes. whenever anything migrates up retina is basically because the traction has not been fully relieved. Maybe the retina is contracting, or maybe something is pulling it, maybe the ERM is pulling it, maybe the PVD is pulling it. So unless you remove all the traction, everything will migrate subretinal. Oil will migrate, PSA will migrate, air will migrate. So whatever you keep on injecting in the eye, if a break is present in the retina and the traction is not relieved, everything will migrate subretinal. So the traction has to be relieved. If it is not relieved, then you have to do a retinectomy. That is why retinectomy is indicated in cases where traction is not relieved. So you'll have to see that. Okay, so I hope that answers the query.
Yes, sir. I think there are no more questions.
Okay, thank you so much. So thank you, Aman, for the exhaustive presentation. And there was, I think, we all learned a lot from it. And there were a lot of instruments were there. And I think this is very extensively covered. And now we all should go and see these instruments physically and remember them and learn from them.
Thank you.
So thank you, Aman, so much for your presentation. Thank you all for attending the class and your time. I hope you all learned from it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Farajat. Thank you.